So I'm going to talk about how to write your own operations framework, if you really have to. And that's the first question. Do you really have to? No, you don't. Other people have written lots of different things. And if you're working in Ruby Chef, it's pretty great. And it'll get you really far. So, and you know, when you have to roll your own thing, it doesn't mean you can't keep using Chef. We're using Chef. And the problems we're trying to solve are, we want something that is very testable. That is our first key desirable. And we need to be able to test things rapidly at the unit level and then integrate it. And then the biggest area of testing is acceptance testing. We want to have our framework bring up real machines and make assertions about the state of those machines. And we want to know that our framework can bring up the machines. You know, we want continuous tests running so we know we can deploy our infrastructure. So we know we can build our infrastructure at all times. So at, you know, 3 in the morning when things are going bad, we don't also have to deal with debugging our deployment code. So that is the main desirable. Right before, you know, we decided to write our own framework at the company I'm working at, we've been using CloudWatch on AWS, not CloudWatch, CloudFormation templates and stuff like that. They're slow and it was hard. They're hard to test. So just designing this framework with test first is a big, big thing. So, and then the rest of the standard stuff, we need to be available. Everything for us is based around high availability. Everything is pretty much a cluster with a load balancer. So we have no single point of failure. And this has to apply to our what's running our, you know, operations framework too. The servers that our ops is running on need to be highly available too. So it needs to bootstrap itself from a local machine into a cluster mode and run like that. Debuggability is big. When a deployment fails, we need to get on the machine, see why it failed, see what's going on. The whole system is based on the concept of swapping out an already running cluster with a newly deployed cluster. So, and you want to keep that old cluster around if you can. I mean, that'd be nice. In case the new one has some problems, just swap back. So also, auditable is a big thing. We want to know, you know, what's going on. Every transition of our operations resource, we want to know why it triggered and was it successful, you know, how long is it taking. We want to know average deploy times, average build times, et cetera. We want to be able to run those analytics. So what's wrong with just Chef? So Chef server is what you would go to kind of provide this whole, you know, framework for managing your settings, managing your machines, doing service discovery, stuff like that. And to make that highly available is non-trivial. And, you know, Chef spec, the testing, you know, that one of the testing libraries that is out there for it, it's just pretty much a unit test. It just doesn't actually do anything. It just tests that your code, you know, can run. And there are some other tools out there like Cucumber Chef, which it comes from this book, Test-Driven Infrastructure Using Chef. And you get to write Cucumber tests that say, like, real machines. It deploys actual AWS resources and then runs your tests on those servers. So that's a pretty cool tool. It's not really under active development right now. And it's not quite flexible for what we wanted to do. And something really cool that's coming out with the same people who did Chef Spec is Test Kitchen. I don't know if anyone's seen this, but it definitely is what we're aiming to do from the testing standpoint. So, but it's under rapid development. So here are the components that I came up with for this framework. It's all API based. So we have ops basically as an API service where and just developers can make API calls from a curl or from whatever, or there's also a front end component that I've built in JavaScript. So the API is like, you know, access. It's just your single point of control. then all the, you know, our business logic is in the domain layer. And that's things like what we consider part of our deployment process. We build images, we deploy clusters, we have some settings and users with permissions. So that's basically our domain. And then the ops is like the whole meat of it. This is all the nasty stuff, working with your cloud library, working with, you know, Unix, getting all the things done that you need to get done to make your domain a reality. We have a database for persistence. We're using MongoDB in a cluster. So the database isn't that important. Whatever you're going to use just needs to be reliable. And then the front end, it can be an app, command line, whatever. That's why you make the API, so you have that flexibility at the front end level. So the API, we have endpoints. It's just rack. So it's pretty simple. We're using Grape. Grape is really nice for writing quick APIs in Ruby. Grape has entities, which are map domain objects to the JSON representation. We're just using JSON in, JSON out. So, and then when we consume a representation that a client has messed with, it's called a representation right now, which is not a great name, but that's to take a representation and go back into the domain layer from there. Then services kind of act as the interface to the domain and ops layer for the API, so it's not highly coupled to what's going on there. And the clients, the API provides some clients, just REST clients, basically. Everything's RESTful. So there are a couple client objects in the API layer that you could use for a command line inside the ops, wherever you need it. And execution is an abstraction for the API to say, go do something. I'm going to respond to the client. And some work is going to go on in the background. And there's I abstracted it because there's a couple different ways just for getting started, just want to fork, you know. But we use AWS Flows a lot to do a lot of our work. So I wanted to make it flexible enough so that when we plug it into our flow infrastructure, we can run our tasks like that. So at the domain layer, we have resources, which have states and logic. And then there are provisioners, which are state machines over these resources. So states, for example, image has a pending state, a building state, a built state, a destroyed state, et cetera. And the provisioner is the state machine that's going to run through all those states with transitions using success and failure. And all this happens in the background. Usually when you ask for a resource to change state, the provisioner is going to determine what it needs to do to change that state and then go about doing that. And that uses the ops layer, where the providers are basically controlled by the provisioner state machines. They communicate using just success and failure and pass an options hash. And then the ops has a lot of, you know, tools to use the cloud services so we can get things done on the cloud. And very important, the testing tools to prove that the things actually got done on the cloud. We want to know processes are running, files, directories, everything's set up, everything's good. Okay, and the database, it's just a database. We use it to store data. There are mappers that map the resources to MongoDB and back. It uses the data mapper pattern. Perpetuity is a cool gem. Right now it just works with Mongo, but they're adding Postgres SQL to it. So I also looked into RomRB, which is pretty cool, but definitely not ready for use. Tried to keep the model persistence out of the domain layer, you know, not active record style. Data mapper is the pattern. It's in patterns of enterprise architecture. If you haven't heard of it, definitely check it out. So the resources transition between states. Transitions are also a resource. This is part of the audibility. We want to know, you know, every transition. So our resources are image, cluster, settings, users, permissions. Right now, it's pretty simple. The providers are the implementations of each resource state. So this is in the ops layer. And you'll write a provider, you'll write like a method called build if you're an image provider, and you'll have like a method pending, build pending, and just that method is called when that resource is going to go into that state. So you need to do everything that will make that resource in the state and then say success inside the provider if you, you know, have achieved it. And then the provisioner will actually update the client and let the resource know that it is in that state at the API level. So the provisioner is just the control object. It knows about the client. And the only transition events are success and failure. So it runs inside an execution with the run IDA as a transition. So a nice feature that we don't have yet would be to take that run ID and cancel transitions. So an example flow for images for us is we start in pending. We set up our image on AWS. We go into a build pending. We, you know, run our, we install Ruby on it. We do everything we want to have the image set up. It takes a while. And, well, that's actually the building state, sorry. And then when it's built, we, you know, make sure it's registered properly and everything like that. So this framework lets us think in terms of state machines, which I think is really valuable. Think about state transitions and think about all your operations resource, all your operations, you know, things as resources that have states that are going to go through state provisions as state transitions as you, you know, deploy things, make things happen. So how do I make it, you know, more of a framework, something reasonable for everybody? So right now it's kind of hard. You build your own subclass of resource, provision, or provider for, you know, your domain object, something you want, you know, to act as a operations resource for you. And then you also have to do your entity, endpoint, and service, and write the mapper for the database. And so it's really like at least seven classes you're going to create to make one operations resource. So that's pretty hard. I've looked into trying to make a DSL to build the resource and provisioner because they're very related. It's basically the states and the state machine. But the state machine is already, I'm using a workflow. It's already a state machine DSL. So it's hard to make frameworks on top of frameworks sometimes, and lots of class-level meta programming. So, but it's interesting, and definitely the roadmap is to do that. There's already a DSL for the API. It's great. And the front end, I made some interesting decisions because I'm a former front end developer. So I'm using Ember.js to just work with JSON. There's no front end server. It's a static JavaScript app, self-contained. So would people be interested in that? It's kind of crazy. Also, Emblem is a templating language, and it's like HAML with handlebars. It's kind of cool. Some cool stuff. So the goal is definitely to open source, you know, the work we've done, and of course profit. So what are our key process benefits from this? So we write acceptance tests using RSpec matchers that run on the instances created by the API. That is really big, because we could have had a broken deployment for weeks and had no idea previously, you know, because we weren't constantly testing our deployment infrastructure. So when a deployment fails, we have SSH access to the machine. We have a one-stop shop for settings and service discovery. Failover is a fundamental construct, swapping clusters back and forth. And it is self-documenting, which is pretty cool. Using Grape, you write a couple descriptions of your endpoints, of your, you know, gets and posts. And then I made an endpoint to represent the endpoints, actually. So there's an entity for the endpoint. So the actual API endpoints can be output as JSON representations. And then you can ask for documentation in JSON. So that was pretty cool. But yeah, it's not done yet. Lots of work. And right now it's kind of monolithic, which is a little bit of a problem because we need to integrate lots of different tools that ops developers are building. And they don't all fit, or, you know, they already work, and how do we work them into this provisioner or provider model? It's a little heavyweight for some lightweight tools. So I'm going to show a couple examples of the front end. So Bootstrap 3, it's very nice and clean. We have the resource states on the clusters pinning down up, some actions, and we have a little menu to go through our deployments. Some of these are just mocks. Basically, the whole thing's not working. We want monitors eventually. We get paged a lot, and sometimes we don't know if what we got paged, it was just transient. So we want a page to look at really quick, you know, just to see if, basically a sanity check to see if, do we really need to, you know, get up at 3 in the morning and get on our computer and get on these servers and see what's up. So, oh yeah, and the nice thing about using this with Bootstrap is it's definitely going to work on a mobile phone. So you'll be able to look at it on your phone in bed. Yeah. And this will change our life. This is a big pain point for us, is how we manage our settings. We run Chef Solo right now. We don't use Chef Server. And our settings are in a bunch of S3 buckets. We have written tools, you know, to update all our buckets, but it's definitely not the easiest to visualize. So this is going to help us a lot. So here's some of my inspiration while doing this. Test-driven infrastructure with Chef, I mentioned. It's a really quick read. It's like 70 pages. If you're interested in, you know, testing your deployment process, check that out. It's kind of hand-wavy, but there is the code. There is the Chef Cucumber Chef that the guy who wrote the book wrote, so you can check that out too. DevOps Weekly is a great newsletter. I pretty much read it every week. They bring up some really cool tools and things people are working on. Just Release It is a very cool book in the Pragmatic Programmer series, or whoever releases that. It's Java-based, but it's all about, you know, handling failure and how important failure is a concept to operations. And of course, you know, when you're building a framework and you're really trying to find this structure, Patterns of Enterprise Architecture is a classic, and Growing Object-Oriented Software Guided by Tests, two really great books. You know, the whole idea is to, you know, start with your unit test, then write your class. So it's good. That was actually pretty quick. So does anyone have any questions? I'm kind of done. Thanks.